warned the people to make sure that their hearts were ready to meet Him, to be looking for His coming. Hallelujah. He warned the people to recognize the difference between what is God and what is not God. Not what's found written on a paper or written in a book, but what is found through the genuine walking and calling of God that is upon our lives. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God wants us to come to a place where we're dependent upon Him. Listen, the one thing that God uses the most is a broken and contrite spirit. Somebody who recognizes that they're not going to make it without Him. Somebody that'll get on their knees and cry and say, God, I'm nothing without You. I don't have anything. I've never been anything. I'll never be anything without You. Somebody who'll get on their face and say, Lord, I love You more than I love myself. And I'm willing to give my life for You just as You gave Your life for me. That's the person that He's looking for. And can I tell you, friend, that's the one that He's going to be coming for at the rapture of the church.
Amen.
He's not going to come for that that's asleep. In fact, we find in the scriptures where he talked about that, right? He said there'll be two in the bed, one will be taken and one will be left. And I'm sure they were sleeping. He said there'll be two at the meal. At the grinding mill, one will be taken and one will be left. There'll be two in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Why? Because those that were taken were looking for His coming. They were getting their hearts ready, making sure everything was right in their heart. Let me tell you about another group that's going in a rapture. That's the 144,000 Jews that will be saved in the first 3.5 years of Daniel's 70th week. Look in Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. Verse 1, he says, after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom was given to hurt the earth and the sea. How many of you know that the wrath of God is going to be poured out on this earth the same way that the wrath of Satan is going to be poured out? But here in these scriptures, God was telling the angels, He said, "Lo, not yet. I want you to hold back. Don't pour my vengeance out upon the earth just yet." Look in verse 3. He says, saying, "Hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of God in their foreheads." In other words, until they've made it right. Until they got it right. He said, don't touch them. Verse 4, it says, "And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and they were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. Of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Gad were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Asher were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Naphtali were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Manasseh were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Simeon was sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Levi were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Zebulun were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Benjamin was sealed 12,000. God always planned a way of escape for His people. God never meant for us to face His wrath. In fact, if you look through the scriptures, you will find, never do you see in the scriptures where the Bible says that our name is put down in form in a book. In other words, he said, Paul talked about our name blotted out of the book. God meant for every single man to be assured of a place with God forever. Jesus would not have come to this earth had He not come for all. The Bible says that He was not willing that any should perish, but all men come to repentance. So God made a way of escape for all of us. But these that were caught up were of the tribe of the Jews that did not receive the Messiah's call. And they were the ones that were left here during the tribulation. They were the ones that were left to suffer. Oh, but how many of you know, according to the scriptures, that God made a way for them? He sent them to a place. He put them in protective custody, if you will, so that they would not suffer the wrath of Satan and the wrath of God. Listen to what we find in Revelation chapter 12. And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to His throne. So just as God, through Christ, redeemed those that were in Christ or in God before Christ, He redeemed those of us that are in the church. He will redeem us. He will also redeem the Jewish nation that believe in Him. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Oh, but what about those that are left? What about those that are caught unawares? What about those of us who for some reason we look up one day and some of our loved ones are gone, or some of our friends are gone? What about those of us who wake up one morning and there's a stark reality we have missed God? Oh Lord, help us. Let me tell you about them. Revelation chapter 6, verse 9 and verse 11. Or 9 through 11. He says, and when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Do you know what you can expect? You can expect that you're going to have to give your life as a martyr for Christ. There is no other way for you to get to heaven after the rapture of the church than to go through the tribulation and be slain for the cause of Christ.
Amen.
What an awakening that is to us. For those of us that think it is so hard to serve God now, what do you think, or how do you think you're going to serve Him when you're going to have to stand before men whose one goal in life is to take your life from you? When they'll thrust you through with a sword, or they'll take a spear and thrust you through, or they'll take your head off because you pronounce Jehovah or you pronounce Christ. Do you know that's coming? There's coming a day. It's even now in China and different places. We find it in the early days. Years ago, there were people that in China that were being crucified and murdered because they spoke the name of Jesus. They had to go into underground caves and they had to go in homes hidden so that they could preach the gospel, so that they could have little cottage prayer meetings. And here today we have all of the privileges of every that we could possibly afford, but yet we just won't even get up out of bed.
Amen.
God help us.
Amen.
God help us. Let me read on. He said, white robes were given to every one of them. Verse 11. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also, and their brethren that should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. Did you know, according to the scriptures, like I said just a minute ago, that you will not escape death during the 7 years of tribulation if you receive the work of Christ, the Messiah, in your life and in your heart? Then not only are you going to have to profess it out loud, but you're going to die for professing it. So don't let me... I don't want to be coy with you this morning. I want to be just as solid and solemn as I possibly can. If you miss the rapture of the church, if you miss the coming of the Lord, when the Bible says, when He steps out on the clouds and redeems His church unto Him, His bride unto Him. If you miss that, as easy as it is now to serve Him, then you better get ready, because you're going to have to die to serve Him.
That's right.
See, right now we don't have to die to serve Him. Right now we can just come and worship the Lord, and we can pray in our homes. We can pray openly in the church. We can get out on the street corner. We can pray just like Juan and I yesterday. We can witness in a hotel. Amen? We can go to Dollywood and pray in the middle of the street for somebody. Without somebody piercing us with a sword or a spear. But my friend, there's coming a day when that won't be so. There's coming a day when we will have to give our life for Christ. So why not give Him our all now? Amen. Why not give Him our best? Revelation chapter 7 verse 9. After this I beheld, lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. In other words, they had been given a robe of righteousness. And cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshipped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and forever. Amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from? And I said unto him, sir, you know. He said unto me, these are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve Him day and night in His temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. Neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them into living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Even those people that are killed in the tribulation period, in the first 3.5 years, even the last 3.5 years, all of those people that are martyred for Christ, one day will put on white robes, hallelujah, and God will wipe away the tears from their eyes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But they still had to pay the price. Revelation chapter 20 verse 4 says, I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them which were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. You see, there's coming. There's coming a blessed time for the children of God. But there's great tribulation. There's great testings. And great things that we have to endure before He comes. And that's why this is so powerful to me personally this morning, to make sure that we get ready. Now let me tell you about the fifth one, the fifth resurrection, the fifth rapture. It's the resurrection of the two witnesses, ending the first resurrection, which began with the resurrection of Christ. Revelation chapter 11 verse 7. And when they had finished their testimony, the beast that ascended out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them and kill them. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom. You ever heard that word before? and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see the dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and shall send gifts one to another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth. Oh, but listen. And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. Did you know that there is two witnesses that are coming during the tribulation period? You remember when the rich ruler spoke to Abraham, and he says, "Hey, would you send somebody to talk to my people? Would you send somebody to talk to my family to let them know that they need to escape this terrible thing, this terrible place that I'm in? Would you send somebody?" Yes. God's going to send two witnesses out of heaven. Two men who had never faced death, one being Enoch. The Bible says Enoch walked with God, and one day he was not, because he was taken. One day he just walked right on up the top of that mountain and stepped right on over into the presence of God. Because God had a plan and a purpose for Enoch. And how many of you know, several years later, there was a man by the name of Elijah. God told Elijah that he was coming after him. He was going to send horses and a chariot after him. And so Elijah went around looking every day for the Lord to come get him. Hallelujah. And one day the Bible says, a great chariot of fire descended out of heaven and came down and scooped Elijah up and took him into heaven.
Amen.
Why? Because God had a purpose and a plan. The Bible says it's appointed a man wants to die, after that the judgment. And so these two witnesses are going to come back during that great tribulation period, during that terrible day of the Lord. And they're going to witness to those that are left behind. And there, the Bible says they will do great signs and miracles and wonders in the heaven, trying to get people to accept the Messiah, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. He's trying to get us. They're going to be trying to get them to receive this great message of hope. Oh, but since it's appointed them to die too, guess what? The Bible says they're going to be murdered by the Antichrist. The Bible says they're going to be so proud of what they've done, they're going to lie them in the streets for the whole world to see. And they're going to leave them lying in state, so to speak, in the streets for 3.5 days. And they're going to laugh and make fun and make merriment. And they're going to say, "Look what we have done. God is nothing and we're everything." But how many of you know that you came to outdo God? That you're not as powerful as God is. You're not as smart as God is. You can't create anything like God can. Amen. The Bible says God is going to send the Spirit of life back into them one day. And the Bible says they're going to raise up, and men's hearts are going to fail them for fear because of what God's going to do. And then if you read over a little bit, you know what he says? He says he's going to call and says, "Come on up. Come on up. I'm finished with you on the earth." Just like he's going to call us up with a great trump of God. "Come on up. You finished your task. You finished your job. Come on up." Hallelujah. Because God is wanting us to understand. He wants us with Him. God does not want us to dwell on this earth forever. He wants us with Him. Amen. Oh, but let me tell you about the last resurrection. This is the one that man should fear. It's called the final resurrection of the dead without Christ. Revelation chapter 20, verse 4. "I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. I saw the souls." I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast neither his image, neither his mark received upon their foreheads or in their hands. They lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Look in verse 7. When the 1,000 years were expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. They went up upon the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about in the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. The books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Now listen to this. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. You know why this is so important? Because in order for them to enter in and be sentenced this way, the Spirit of God has to be removed from them. And once the Spirit of God is removed from them, there is no drawing toward God, and all light leaves, and there's nothing but absence of light. Did you know that's what darkness really is? Absence of light? There's no such measurement for darkness. It's absence of light. And so when God is removed, where He says God is light, when God is removed, then all there is absence of light. And whoever is found in absence of light, the Bible says, is going to be cast into the lake of fire, which burneth forever and forever. Now the reason that I wanted to share these with you, because my goal and my purpose